Hey there, thank you so much for stopping by to hang out with me for a few minutes of your day with me today. Just a quick thing here, I've got a fan running back here that I was told in a live stream earlier today wasn't a nuisance. I'm still going to make an effort to try to edit any of it out that I can in post, but if you hear a fan, that's why. I'm sorry, it's just 86 degrees here in the studio this afternoon. So I hope you'll bear with me through that, but let's jump into the video. So in our last video, we took a look at getting Docker set up and running, and we even deployed a Docker container using OpenMediaVault's built-in Compose functionality. So if you haven't seen the previous two videos in this series, please go check those out as well. They're in a playlist, should be linked in the video description. So in this video, I want to look more into the OpenMediaVault Compose feature and talk about some of the stuff that you can do with it. But before we get into this, there are a couple of quick things. In the comment section of our last video, a few people asked about using Portainer with OpenMediaVault 7, and yes, you can absolutely use Portainer if you want to. You can either install Portainer using OpenMediaVault's Compose, or you can jump into the terminal for your OpenMediaVault server and deploy it that way. Either way should work equally well, completely up to you. Now, more specifically in this video, I want to look at remote storage, backups, remote backups, and restoring backups. I think those are all very, very crucial things to have when you're getting into home labbing. Now, the thing is, if you don't have a way to do a remote backup, that's fine. You can kind of just skip that section of the video, but just know that for the best chance of keeping a backup safe, you really should have some sort of a remote backup available to you to keep it off of this device. And the other thing to get out of the way real quick is that I do have some bills to pay. So here's a quick message from today's video sponsor. This video is sponsored by EWin Racing and their Flash XL size upgraded ergonomic gaming and office chair. This is a big chair that has all of the creature comforts you would expect from a quality product. The Flash XL features Brissa Ultra PU leather for its breathable performance fabric and proprietary ventilation system to keep you from getting all hot and sweaty while you're doing everything from fragging bad guys in your favorite game to scouring the internet for your next new thing to test out in your home lab. It also comes with memory foam, headrest, and lumbar pillows for maximum comfort. And the headrest is magnetic, so you can set it where you want without those bothersome straps getting in the way and complicating things. The armrests are attached with magnets for easy replacements if you ever need to do that, and they're adjustable in multiple directions, so you can dial in the chair to get the most out of your ergonomic setup. As the name implies, this is the XL, and it's meant for chair enthusiasts ranging from 5'7" to 7 feet tall, and supports up to 550 pounds. To fully dial in the comfort of the Flash XL, there are two different lumbar knobs that allow you to adjust the 4D lumbar support to fit your unique body shape. The seat and the back are firm, but not hard, so you can sit for long periods of time without worrying about your butt and legs falling asleep while you're getting the support that your body needs. Be sure to check out the link in the video description to get more information and a discount code to pick up an EWin racing chair for yourself and save some cash in the process. So just jumping right in, if we head down to the Compose section under services, we'll see all of the different menu items available, and we're going to talk about some of the stuff in there. Just another side note here, there are a few different things on a few of these pages that aren't even in the OMV Extras documentation page for some reason. I'm guessing it's a if you know, you know situation, but that's not really a great answer if you ask me. The first thing that we're going to take a look at, we already kind of took a look at in the previous video. This is on the settings page, and I want to talk about the backup section. Now, the way we set this up in the previous video has backups on the OpenMediaVault server. And as I mentioned a moment ago, this isn't necessarily ideal. If your system crashes or you lose a hard drive or whatever, local backups aren't exactly ideal for making sure that we've always got access to our data. So with that said, later in this video, we're going to take a look at setting up remote mounts and setting our backups to be stored on a different device on our network. In the demonstration today, I'm going to be using a Synology NAS. But we'll come back to that in a bit. Now, with most of the rest of the menu items under Compose, we're going to talk briefly about them, but you can get more details on them by going over to the OMV Extras website and digging through their wiki about Compose. Now, we've already looked at the files page in a previous video, but this is where you can deploy and edit containers. And if you're familiar with Portainer, think of this page like the Portainer Stacks page. Now, I also do want to briefly touch on the Add from Example menu option under the Add button here on the Files page. If you click the Add from Example, you'll be taken to a page where you can select from dozens of pre-built Docker Compose templates to quickly and easily deploy any number of containers with really very little effort. Now, of course, they do require a bit of editing, but it's honestly pretty straightforward, especially if you've watched the previous videos in this playlist. On our Services tab, we'll see all of the containers on our system and the relevant information about each one, like the name, image, project, service, state, status, and ports. Again, referring back to Portainer, for those who know it, this page should also look very, very familiar. The stats page will show you the stats of each container running on your system. This will include the name, CPU usage, memory limit, memory usage percentage based on the previous two entries, net in, net out, as well as block in and block out, as well as the PID or process identifier. The images page will list out any of the Docker images we have on the server, including the repository, tag, when it was created, its size, status, and whether it's being used. The networks page will allow us to view the existing networks, create new networks, and delete or inspect existing networks on the system. The volumes page will allow us to view any Docker volumes we have on the system, including their name, size, mount point, and drive. I don't currently have any of these on my system because I'm using mount points that are actually mounted to predetermined volumes on the server that we set up in previous videos. But we can also delete and inspect them from the menu across the top. Another, because there's going to be a lot of these, it seems, another side note is that I'm not sure that Compose backups will actually back up Docker volumes. So if you want to back those up, you may have to find an alternative method. The containers page will allow us to see the containers that we have on the system and see the name, image, state, status, ports, and mount points for each container. The Dockerfiles page will allow us to see the Dockerfiles we have on the system, as well as create, edit, delete, build, and pull and build, as well as create a new image tag. Now, the reality is I don't have much familiarity with building Docker images of my own, so this is a little bit out of my comfort zone. So we're not going to go into any more detail in this section, at least for now. Now, the last two items in this list are really what I wanted to get into in this video. Schedule allows us to create, edit, delete, or run a scheduled task. So if we click the blue circle with the white plus sign, we'll create a new schedule. Now we'll be asked which containers we want this to apply to, or we can select the asterisk or the star symbol to select all of the containers. Below that, we'll have the action type, and this will let us run backups, updates, or prune dangling images. Now, each of these options have descriptions under them with more details, but be careful when using the update and prune options. They may overwrite, update, or delete something you didn't want them to as part of their process. So again, be careful when using update and prune in your scheduling. There's also an option to run scripts before and or after the backup script is run, so you can put those there if you need to. So next, we've got the ability to schedule when you want these things to happen, and I really appreciate that they've got this set up the way that they do, as I hate trying to set up cron jobs. I've just never enjoyed setting them up in command line and always appreciate an easy-to-use interface like this. Then there's the option to send an email with details about the job when it's complete, if you want to do that, but you will need to set up an email server in Open Media Vault for this to work. Now, the restore page is exactly that. It will have a list of the backups available to your system that you can select and then restore. Honestly, pretty straightforward here as well. So now we're going to get into remote mounts and that sort of thing, but there are a couple of prerequisites for setting up remote mounts. First, again, you'll need a remote device to mount to. I'm going to use a Synology NAS to set up a shared folder via SMB/CIFS. And once you've got that shared folder created the way you want with all of the permissions and that sort of thing, you'll want to head back over to your Open Media Vault dashboard and then click System and then click Plugins. Then we're going to search for Remote in the search box on the Plugins page. We'll click the Open Media Vault - Remote Mount plugin and then click the Install button at the top of the page there. Once that's done installing, we'll click the storage link in the left menu, and we should now see Remote Mount as an option. Click that and then click the blue circle with the white plus sign in it. Give the remote mount a name and then enter the IP address of your remote server. And again, this is going to be my NAS's IP address. Next, you'll enter the share name. On my Synology, I named the share OMV7TUT, so that's what I'm going to enter here into OMV. Then you'll enter the appropriate username and password for the share on your remote server. Next, you can change the options below as necessary and then click Save. You should then be redirected back to the remote mounts page, and you'll need to click the check mark in the yellow bar across the top of the page, and then confirm that you actually want to save your work. Now, before we can actually set anything up with the backup solution that we're going to go with, we need to set up a shared folder. So we're going to head over to Storage and then Shared Folders, and then create a new shared folder. So to do that, we're going to click the blue circle with the white plus sign in it again, and then we're going to give the shared folder a name. I called mine OMV Sino Backup. You can name yours whatever you want to. Then you're going to select the remote share that we just set up, and then choose the permissions you want for your setup and add tags if you want, then click Save. Now, again, you should be redirected back to the shared folders page, and you'll need to click the check mark in the yellow bar across the top of the page, and then confirm that you actually do want to save. Now, we're actually going to reconfigure our backup to use the remote share that we just configured. So we're going to go over to Services, Compose, and then Settings. And now we'll go down to the backup section and select the shared folder we just created with our remote mount. Scroll down, click Save, and go through the process of clicking the check mark in the yellow bar and clicking Save and confirming, and then we can move on to the next step. So now that we've actually got a remote mount, our next step is actually going to be going back to the Compose Files area where we looked at deploying Bookstack. Now I'm going to make some changes to the default Docker Compose from the example template that we used, and again, most of this is going to be pretty straightforward if you've watched the previous videos in this series or playlist. Now, the biggest thing that I've noticed from my own experience is that putting the database directory in the same subdirectory as the app directory seems to give me the best results when restoring apps using the built-in backup and restore in Open Media Vault's Compose feature. That could just be a me thing. Check it out for yourself, but that's what I've noticed for myself. So with that little sidebar out of the way, I'm going to go back and deploy Bookstack. Once it's been deployed, we'll log in and create a book just so that we've got something in there to verify when we do our restore here in a moment. So at this point, we've got our test Docker container set up, and we've already got a schedule that which is kind of a test schedule that we set up earlier. But again, you can set up that schedule however you need to for your needs. So what I'm going to do is actually click on the schedule that we set up earlier. Then I'm going to click the square icon with the triangle in it to manually run the backup. Once that's done, you can go back to your remote server and then check the shared folder to make sure that the backups are there. If it is, great. If not, go back and check your settings and make sure you didn't miss a step or misconfigure something. So now that I've got a backup of my Bookstack on the remote server, I'm going to go back to Open Media Vault, and I'm going to go to Systems, Compose, and Files, and then I'm going to select the Bookstack container. Then I'm going to click the Delete button, and I know that seems like counterintuitive, but that's what we're going to do here. Now that's going to stop and delete the Bookstack application container as well as the associated database container from that Docker Compose. That said, it's also going to delete the Docker Compose that we used to deploy our Bookstack setup. But don't worry about that. All of that is actually included in the backup that we've created and should come back when we do our restore. Once all of the Bookstack stuff is deleted, you can go back to the restore page, click Bookstack, and then click the restore button above. And in a moment or two, the restoration should be complete. So now we'll head back up to Files and we should see Bookstack. Click it and then click the up button above and let it redeploy. So once it's done deploying, you should be able to see your recently created, backed up, deleted, and restored Bookstack instance back up and running here and in your browser window. So there you go. We took a bit more of a look at Compose and also set up a remote SMB share and configured remote backups in OMV. We also deployed a container, modified it a bit, backed it up, deleted it, and restored it. In future videos, we're going to take a look at things like Open Media Vault 7's Compose alternatives like Portainer and Dockage, as well as maybe deploying some other containers just for the practice of it. If there are any specific things that you'd like to see in upcoming videos, be sure to leave those down in the comments. And also, if this video is helpful to you, you might consider liking and subscribing. If you'd like to do more and you're able to, you can also support the channel by becoming a channel member, a patron, or you can donate via PayPal if you want to do that instead. Again, none of that is obligatory, but it is definitely appreciated. But with that said, I am going to go ahead and wrap up this video. Again, thank you so much for spending a few minutes of your day with me today, and I'll talk to you in the next video.